In this video, we're going to take another look at chemical equilibrium, specifically taking a look at what's known as manipulating chemical equilibrium reactions. Oftentimes, chemists are called upon to try to create a specific outcome with equilibrium reactions, and it may be necessary to sometimes write a reaction in reverse or change the balanced equation coefficients and do other things to manipulate the equations to get the desired outcome. That's what we'll take a look at in this particular video clip. The first thing we'll look at in manipulating equilibria is what happens if we reverse the direction of the equilibrium reaction. Now, if we reverse the direction of the equilibrium reaction, what happens is the original constant in the forward direction, when we reverse it, it's going to become the reciprocal mathematically of what the original reaction was. Now, in any chemical equation, the way we write the equation has an influence on how we interpret what is reactant and product. In this particular reaction, whatever we have written on the right side of the arrow is considered products. Whatever is written on the left side gives us our reactants. When we set up our equilibrium constant, it's a ratio of our products divided by the reactants. Specifically, we have our NH3 raised to the second power, and then in our denominator, we have our nitrogen and our hydrogen with the hydrogen raised to the third power. By convention, this is how we set up our equilibrium constant expression. Now, for this particular reaction, as it's written, let's just say for purposes of our example that the constant is equal to 6. Now, if we take the original reaction and just write it in reverse, flip-flop the reaction, we come up with this particular chemical equation. Now, once again, whatever's on the left side is considered to be a reactant. Now, once again, whatever's on the left side would be considered to be our reactant. And the materials on the right side of the arrow would be what we consider to be our products. Now, mathematically, what this does is by reversing it, we now have our products over reactants becomes exactly the opposite of what we had in our original equation. Consequently, the value of the equilibrium constant becomes the reciprocal of what it was for the original equation. Now, instead of the value of the constant being 6, by writing the reaction in reverse, it becomes 1 over 6, or 0.17, is the value of the constant for the same reaction, just written in the reverse direction. Now, another means of manipulating equations is sometimes we might change what the coefficients are in the balanced equation. Now, when we do this, the new equilibrium constant will be raised, whatever it is, the n power of the original value of the constant. So here we have our original equation again. As it's written, products are on the right, reactants are on the left, and here's the value, the setup for our equilibrium constant and the value of the constant for this equation as written. Now, if we take the original equation, and merely what we're doing here is just doubling what the coefficients are in the balanced equation. What that does is because the coefficients become exponents in our equilibrium constant expression, mathematically what happens if we take the original equation, the coefficient of 2 that gives us a square, we double that to give us a 4 for the balanced equation. So now instead of a square, we're raising something to the fourth power. Mathematically what this is doing is we're actually squaring the value of the overall constant. So now when we've doubled the coefficients in the balanced equation, the value of the constant becomes a square of the original constant, and instead of being equal to 6, the value of the constant for the newly balanced equation becomes 36, or 6 squared. Take a look at another example with this. In this case, we're taking the coefficients of the balanced equation and cutting everything in half. Now, once again, what that's going to do is mathematically, our exponents now change to 1/2 of what they were originally. Raising something to the 1/2 power is the same as taking the square root. So with this newly balanced equation where all the coefficients are 1/2 of what they were for the original equation, the value of our constant becomes 6 raised to the 1/2, or the square root of the original value. So instead of being 6 as it was for the originally balanced equation, it becomes the square root of 6, which is 6 or 2.45, would be the value of the constant in its newly balanced form. Our next manipulation we'll look at is sometimes it's necessary to take several equilibrium equations and combine them together to get a different chemical equation. We'll look at how we can combine chemical equilibrium equations. Now, when combining chemical equilibrium equations, the new reaction that we get for the chemical equilibrium is the sum of two or more other equilibrium reactions. The K for the overall new reaction is going to be the product. So, for example, if we have to take some reaction and we achieve it by adding together two separate chemical equilibrium equations, the new constant we would get by taking the K for reaction 1 and multiplying it by the K for reaction 2 gives us our new overall constant. For example, we have this reaction, reaction number 1. We have reaction number 2, and we're going to take these two reactions and add them together to get a new overall reaction. Now, when we add the reactions together, keep in mind that the arrow in here functions similar to an equal sign in a math equation. So when we're combining these two equilibriums, because we have an NO here on the product side and an NO in this reaction on the reactant side, those NOs are going to cancel each other out, and they don't appear in the new overall equation. Here we have our 1 half N2. That's going to remain uncanceled. 1 half BR2 and 1 half O2. They all come down to give us our reactants in the new equation. The only product that didn't cancel out is the NOBR, and that gives us our new product in the new overall chemical equilibrium equation. So what's happened here is reaction 1 has been added to reaction 2 to give us a new overall chemical equilibrium equation. That's the combination of reactions 1 and reaction 2. Now, reaction 1 has its own equilibrium constant, K1, which is 1 times 10 to the negative 15th, and K2, which is 9. Now, to arrive at the new equilibrium constant for the overall reaction, which we just got by adding together reaction 1 and reaction 2, that's going to be taking K1 times K2 of the reactions that were added together. So we have our K1, 1 times 10 to the negative 15th. Multiply that by our K2 for the two reactions that we added together to get the new overall equation, and that'll give us the new equilibrium constant for the equation that we got by adding together reactions 1 and reaction 2. The last thing we'll take a look at manipulating equilibria is interpreting something known as the reaction quotient, which is Q. Now, in working with chemical equilibrium, we can say the system is at equilibrium. When we calculate the equilibrium constant, it comes out that everything is equal to, the concentrations put in the constant expression, becomes equal to the equilibrium constant. When that's true, the system's at equilibrium. However, let's say we have calculation, we have our concentrations of the reactants and products, we place them in the equilibrium constant expression, and if it comes out where it does not equal the constant, meaning the system's not at equilibrium, it's no longer referred to as the equilibrium constant, but it's something called the reaction quotient, or Q. For example, we have this reaction. Here's our equilibrium constant expression, products over reactants. That's going to be equal to some equilibrium constant K. When this is an equality, putting numbers in for our reactants and products, and we calculate it out, if it's equal to the equilibrium constant, then we know the system is at equilibrium under those conditions. Say we have the exact same system again. We calculate, we put in concentrations of our reactants and products, and it comes out where it does not equal K. In this case, when it doesn't equal K, it's not referred to as equilibrium constant, but rather it's referred to something known as the reaction quotient, or Q. Now let's say in this particular circumstance, we've calculated it, and the value it's greater than K. Or we can say the value of our reaction quotient is greater than K. What this tells us is, with this system not being at equilibrium, is there's too much product. Because if Q is bigger than K, that means the size of our numerator here is too big, and the size of the denominator that we have is too small. The reaction's going to shift, trying to reach equilibrium. Now, in this case, the reaction wants to get rid of excess product and generate more reactant. So it's going to shift to the left, because when the reaction shifts to the left, what's going to happen is the amount of reactant is going to go up, the amount of product is going to go down, and the issue of Q, or the reaction quotient, being too big, larger than K, will be alleviated, and the shifting will stop once Q becomes equal to K, because once we're equal to K, that means the system is then at equilibrium, and the shifting would then stop. Now, in another scenario, if we plug in concentrations for our reactants and products, and we calculate it out, and it becomes out to be less than K, and our Q is less than K, again, this means that the system is not at equilibrium. With Q being less than K, that tells us we have too much reactant. In this case, with too much reactant, our denominator, or the reactants, is too big. The numerator, or what represents the product, is too small. When we see this type of result where Q is less than K, the reaction wants to alleviate this and return to equilibrium. What it can do is, if the reaction shifts to the right, that's going to cause the amount of product. The amount of product would then increase, the amount of reactant in each case would decrease. That would eventually make Q here become larger, and once Q becomes equal to K, the system would be at equilibrium and the shifting would then stop.